Mr. Chairman, ladies and gentlemen, first of all, I would like to thank the organizers for inviting me. My apologies for this trouble, but there was some change in the schedule. So I have 12 minutes to talk about the efficacy of catheter ablation, of atrial fibrillation, and I will do this by addressing two questions. So if you have a treatment modality, in order to be able to judge the efficacy of this treatment, you need to define the objectives of the treatment. And the second question, it's the final question I will address, is what is the definitive treatment? What do we mean when we talk about definite treatment? And is catheter ablation of atrial fibrillation really a definite treatment? So let's start with a more important objective of catheter ablation. It was introduced and developed in order to treat patients with atrial fibrillation. And that means that you have to suppress atrial fibrillation, you have to prevent arrhythmia recurrences. So the first case of ablation in the left atrium was published in December 1994 by the Hazard-Gehr group, and they showed that it is feasible to perform catheter ablation of atrial fibrillation. And indeed, the early studies, this is a summary of the early studies coming from, or were published in 2003 and 2004, they show a high success rate, and the aim or the data were presented as percent free of atrial fibrillation. And what you can see is there's a high success rate when we define the aim of this treatment as suppression of atrial fibrillation recurrences, and in some groups it exceeded 80%. This was a study, or the studies came from very experienced centers, and these were highly selected patients. And again, all these data show that it is possible to suppress arrhythmia recurrence by catheter ablation of atrial fibrillation. However, the data coming from the real world are somewhat different. This is a registry from the ESC era. More than 3,000 patients were included all over Europe, and it shows recurrence rates for different types of atrial fibrillation, paroxysmal, persistent, and long-standing persistent atrial fibrillation. And what you can see is that after 1 year, the probability of event or recurrence rate is in the range of 50%. And it's interesting to see how the follow-up was performed in this study. So in almost one half of the patients, the follow-up was not the Holter and not the implantation of a cardiac monitor. It was just a telephone contact with the patient. So it's likely that the real recurrence rate is much higher than reality. Even in Germany, the situation is not really better. The data coming from Germany registry, more than 3,000 patients. And what you see here is the recurrence rate is almost 50%, and almost 50% of the patients underwent a repeat ablation. And one may say Germans are stupid, but Karl-Heinz Cook and Gerd Hinrichs and all these very experienced centers contributed to this data. So there are recurrences. I like this study here by Piotrkowski, Christopher Piotrkowski. It was published last year. He implanted an implantable cardiac monitor, and all his patients who underwent catheter ablation, more than 400 patients were implanted, were ablated, 419 consecutive patients, and here are the recurrence rate. This means that we have to deal with recurrences when we do catheter ablations in patients with atrial fibrillation. We are not able to completely prevent recurrences, and we have a relatively high recurrence rate. But these data and this endpoint, recurrence, is not the ideal endpoint. This endpoint comes from the very early drug studies where we had new antiarrhythmic drugs, where we did Holter, and where we just asked whether the patient has a recurrence or not. But clinical efficiency is something else, and it differs from just having a recurrence, and this has to be taken into account, and therefore one can say the primary aim of ablation is not just to reduce arrhythmia recurrence, but also symptoms and to improve quality of life. So further endpoints which are added, and the aims of catheter ablation are coming more complex. So most of the studies I've shown, they show some symptom reduction. So we have not just a reduction in the recurrences, but also reduction in symptoms. We don't have so many studies having assessed the quality of life in these patients. Most of the studies we have are retrospective, are observational, and this is just an example of a study published in 2015. We have an observational study, consecutive patients. We have patients with sinus rhythm, AF occurrences, and we have the assessment of quality of life at baseline, the black bars, and post-ablation, the white lines. And as you can see, there is some difference in the quality of life, baseline, post-ablation in these patients without AF recurrences have an improvement in quality of life, but as you can see, the effects are not so marked. But they overall, they show that there is some improvement in quality of life. So we have talked about endpoints, and another objective of catheter ablation could be to reduce arrhythmia recurrences and symptoms, to improve quality of life, and to improve prognosis. And prognosis is the hardest endpoint we have, and for me, this is the most important endpoint for catheter ablation of atrial fibrillation. For many years, we did not have the data allowing to say whether catheter ablation improves prognosis or not, but now we have the data. We have two important studies. They have been discussed extensively. They are under discussion, and discussion is ongoing and will ongoing for the next couple of years. And one of the important studies is the CASTLE-AF study. It was a study performed in patients with heart failure and atrial fibrillation. So very special patient population. All these patients had an implanted cardiac defibrillator. So it was relatively easy to look for arrhythmia recurrences because these devices are able, like the implantable cardiac monitor, to detect atrial fibrillation. And this study found, and that's not surprising, that patients who underwent a catheter ablation, the red bars, this is the baseline data, they have a reduction in the burden of atrial fibrillation. We do catheter ablation, we have some reduction in the incidence of recurrences, so we have a reduction in the burden of atrial fibrillation. But this was not the primary endpoint of the study. Burden of atrial fibrillation was measured, and that was one of the aims of catheter ablation, but the primary endpoint was death or hospitalization for worsening of heart failure. And here you can see, although this study has some limitations, but we don't have the time to discuss these limitations today, there was a significant reduction of the endpoint, which included symptoms, worsening of heart failure, but also death. And if you have a look on the left side, there is a secondary endpoint, and this is death from any cause. And you can see that patients with or patients who underwent catheter ablation had a better survival, lower mortality when compared to patients having medical therapy. And for me, a very important information coming from this figure is that the effects did not appear at the beginning of the study, so it took some time until the positive effects of catheter ablation were visible. And you can see here that after 2 years, the separation of the survival curve, so catheter ablation, it looks like that it needs some time until it can show its beneficial effects on survival. There is another study which has gained enormous interest recently, and this is Cabana. You all have heard the results. It was presented last year, and these were not patients with heart failure. These were patients who presented with new onset atrial fibrillation or with untreated atrial fibrillation, and they underwent randomization to catheter ablation and medical therapy. So a large number of patients, more than 2,000 patients, and the duration of follow-up was more than 5 years. And this is the final result. This is the result of the intention to treat analysis. This is not the primary endpoint, but this is recurrences of atrial fibrillation. And again, we see that there is a reduction in atrial fibrillation in patients undergoing catheter ablation. And this is what we expect and what has been demonstrated with all the data and studies I have shown. But with regard to the primary endpoint, this is the results of intention to treat analysis. The primary endpoint was death, disabling stroke, serious bleeding, and cardiac arrest. And there is no difference between patients receiving catheter ablation and those treated by drugs. In the talk, in the first talk when the data were presented, and per protocol analysis and even though there was no difference in mortality as a secondary endpoint. Packer also presented the per protocol data, and you all know that we love all evidence-based medicine and we love this attention to treat analyses, but the aspects, they become active in such a study are very special, and I think there are some good arguments to say per protocol analysis should be performed, and when this per protocol analysis was performed, so patients were evaluated based on the fact whether they underwent catheter ablation or not or received drugs, there was a significant reduction in the primary endpoint. You can see here patients with ablation had significantly lower event rate. So does catheter ablation now reduce mortality or not? I think this Study Cabana has one special aspect, and this has to be realized, and it is extremely important that the crossover rate was very high. So we had a study, randomized study, we have the attention to treat analysis was, but we have a really high crossover rate. So almost one third of the patients who were randomized to receive medical therapy underwent catheter ablation. And that makes the analysis and the interpretation of the data very difficult. And it's like the discussion we had with the AFFIRM study where rhythm control and rate control were compared. The primary aim of the study was, for me, not to assess the efficacy of catheter ablation in comparison to drugs, but to compare treatment strategies. Treatment strategies were compared. So it was randomized, it was decided whether the patient received catheter ablation, or drugs, and the IT analysis shows that it's possible to start with both therapeutic possibilities, with drugs and with catheter ablation. When we look for the efficacy, there are data suggesting that even Cabana shows that ablation is more effective than drug therapy. So my last question, very short, is ablation of atrial fibrillation a definite treatment? So we have to design or define what is a definite treatment. This is an example or one possible definition. The treatment or definite treatment is a treatment plan for a disease or disorder that has been chosen as the best one for a patient after all other choices have been considered. And my answer to this question is, and this is the final slide, yes, I believe that catheter ablation is a definite treatment because in many patients we do not have a better choice, and we have data suggesting that we can achieve a reduction in AF recurrences, a reduction in symptoms, an improvement in quality of life, and some improvement in survival. Also, the quality of the data is not so good as we would like to see them, but we have many indices suggesting that catheter ablation has beneficial effects. Thank you.